Welcome everyone to this session. It's an E15 session, so it's a part of an initiative that ICTSD is running together with the World Economic Forum, looking at the future of the global trade system. And today we're going to focus on the results of two groups of the E15, one that has been looking at clean energy and another one looking at climate change. So welcome everyone. I should introduce myself. My name is Inge Jigu. I'm from ICTSD. I manage our work on climate and clean energy. And in the area of the E15, I've been managing those two groups, so the one on clean energy and the one on climate change. So climate change, of course, is more than an environmental problem. It has been described by the UN Secretary General as the defining issue of our time. And he said that if we don't take urgent action, all our plans for increased global prosperity and security will be undone. So this, of course, requires a concerted effort across policy areas to really address the climate change problem. And it's in this light that we want to consider the contribution of trade and investment. We are just coming back from Paris on COP21, where a universal agreement was adopted, which I think was a great achievement. And as a part of that outcome, there is more than 180 intended nationally determined contributions that have been submitted. So countries' plans on climate action. And that's a very broad, it's a very broad action that is going to be undertaken, much broader than we have seen in the past. And in the UNFCCC, there is no definition of what is a climate measure. So what we're going to see in the coming years is the development of new sets of policies varying between different countries, depending on their circumstances and capacities. And we can expect that this is going to impact energy supply, energy use, production, consumption, international competitiveness, transport, and everything that actually has to do with trade. So we can expect an increasing interlinkage between trade and climate change. Some tensions, but I think that in the area of the E15, we have really been trying to focus more than the tensions on the possible opportunities and solutions and the positive role that trade can play in addressing climate change. So today, we wanted to focus on the WTO-related opportunities in the area of trade and climate change, because many of the opportunities can actually be grasped unilaterally or in regional trade agreements. But since we're doing this E15 session in parallel with the WTO negotiations, we wanted to focus on the WTO-relevant options. In Davos, in the World Economic Forum in January, we're going to launch the full full E15 initiative and the final reports, and that's going to include a broader range of options. So today we have a very distinguished panel with excellent both speakers and commentators. So from the speakers we have Professor Kasturi Das, who is from the Institute of Management Technology in Ghaziabad in India. And Kasturi is a member of the Climate Change E15 group. So she's going to give us a brief overview of the, I think, how many options did we end up with? 35 options or something like that. After Kasturi, we would hear from Tom Brewer, who is a senior fellow with ICTSD. And Tom actually is a member of both the E15 groups that we're going to talk about today. But today, Tom is going to focus more on the clean energy side. And then to my right, we have Ricardo Melendez-Ortiz, who is a known figure to many of you. And in addition to being the chief executive of ICTSD and the director of the E15 initiative, he is also the theme leader of the Clean Energy E15 group. So Ricardo is going to talk about issues that are relevant to both the groups, the clean energy group and the climate group. So something is a bit in the intersection between the two. On my left side, we have our panel of discussants. So we have Ambassador Jakob Brix-Tange from Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Denmark. We have Ambassador Alvaro Cedeno Molinari, who is from the Permanent Representation of Costa Rica to the WTO. And to the far left, Anka Schild, who is a senior policy advisor from Siemens AG in Brussels. So we are going to hear government perspective, or two government perspectives, and the private sector perspective, providing some reactions to the options that we are going to listen to. So first, I would like to give the floor to Kasturi. So I would like to ask the presenter to stick to 12 to 15 minutes or something like that, so that we will have time for discussion. So Kasturi, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ingrid. Very good morning to everyone. First of all, I must thank ICTSD, particularly Ricardo and Ingrid and their team, for giving me this opportunity to interact with this august audience. Indeed, an honor and privilege for me to be here. Now, as Ingrid has already briefed you about the trade implications of climate change, let me make this point upfront that in today's world, which is an interconnected world, we cannot think of climate issues or climate regimes as mutually exclusive from the trade regimes. Particularly when you are dealing with a problem like climate change, which has if it is a multidimensional phenomena and has implications for almost everything under the sun, I would say, it is hardly possible for you to think of a scenario where climate-related actions and regimes would not have implications for what is happening to trade in goods and services and investments. So in that context, it is very important for us to appreciate that in today's world, we cannot think of mutually exclusive trade regime and climate regime. However, the problem is that if you look at the current scenario, despite the interconnectedness which is there, you don't get to see that kind of interaction happening already among the policymakers who are dealing with climate change on the one hand and trade on the other. And it is because of this lack of communication, and you know, there are issues about jargons, trade parlance, climate-related jargons and all that, lack of understanding on both sides about these issues. What we can see currently is a kind of an atmosphere of some kind of uneasiness, I would say, and some sort of suspicion also to some extent. For instance, the climate policymakers are a bit worried that their ability to undertake climate action might be curtailed by trade law, particularly WTO law, because all of us know that WTO has this dispute settlement system, which gives WTO the much-needed teeth, which makes it enforceable. On the other hand, if you look at the trade people, the policymakers dealing with trade, their apprehension is that even if they deal with climate change as a very special kind of a problem, which requires special actions on the part of the WTO, like creating exceptions, etc., there is always a risk of opening a Pandora's box. So, you know, other people can come up with other kinds of issues and ask for similar exceptions once you have created that kind of exceptions for climate. Now, these kinds of suspicions and apprehensions are, you know, playing around. And this is happening because there is a gap in terms of interaction and understanding. And it is exactly for this reason that this E15 expert group on measures to address climate change and the trade system is trying to address this gap. What we have done in this expert group is, you know, we have come up with a set of policy options, some 35 policy options, and these are addressed towards the trade policymakers and also towards the climate policymakers. The whole idea is that to make them appreciate the interconnectedness of trade and climate regimes on the one hand, and also to make them, or to urge them to appreciate that they must, each side must also appreciate the legitimacy of the goals of the other. Once they appreciate that, it is also important that they start talking about these issues which are in the interface of climate regime and trade regime more extensively than what has been happening now. So that is the context from which we are coming. Now, before getting into the details of the interface that might come up from a climate change perspective with trade regime, let me give you a little bit background about the climate regime and what are the kind of challenges we face there when we deal with climate change. First of all, we have to appreciate that climate change is a multidimensional phenomenon. And though there have been initiatives under the United Nations Framework Convention on Climate Change starting in early 1990s, to come up with a regime to deal with the problem in an effective manner, if you look at the history of the working of this regime, you will find that how difficult it has turned out to be, and why not? Because you are dealing with a set of around 200 countries which have very different contributions towards the problem, very different extent of vulnerabilities to the problem of climate change, the phenomenon of climate change, and also different capabilities to deal with the problem. At the same time, each of these countries would have their domestic scenarios, their own imperatives, priorities back home, and of course, most importantly, there would be political compulsions and ramifications which they have to take care in order to deal with any policy actions on climate change. Now, if you are dealing with such diverse set of some 200 countries, then it is quite obvious that you would expect that some challenges, a lot of challenges would be there in proceeding with the negotiations. We are aware from the WTO experience how difficult it has turned out to be to deal with complex issues at the multilateral level. What makes life all the more difficult when we are dealing with a problem like climate change is that if you talk of climate change mitigation, that is how to reduce your emissions of greenhouse gases to tackle the problem of climate change, that is about mitigation. So if you are dealing with mitigation, then we also have to appreciate that it has this nature of public good characteristic. So what it means is that if some one country is undertaking some climate action on mitigation, for instance, and that is helping the scenario of climate change, then all other countries would be equally benefited. The entire world is going to be benefited. So there is no rivalry in terms of the benefit. At the same time, it is not possible for the country which is undertaking the mitigation action to exclude all other countries from, you know, enjoying the benefits of its own action. So that is about non-excludability. So these are the two characteristics of a public good we are aware of. And this is where the problem of free riding comes on board, because there would always be a tendency for countries to free ride on other countries' efforts. And these are some of the challenges which have turned out to be quite difficult to deal with in the multilateral context when you're dealing with large group of countries. Now, of course, when we are discussing here these issues today, only a few days back, we already had an agreement, a Paris Agreement, which has been appreciated by the world with much fanfare. I would not, time does not permit me to get into the nitty-gritty details of the Paris Agreement, and nor do I want to sound pessimistic about it, but let me put things in perspective, at least try to do so. Though we have an agreement which I think is an important step forward in the right direction, because you have a system now in place under which, as Ingrid was pointing out, intended nationally determined contribution, that is the climate parlance you use to indicate voluntary actions being pledged by different parties to the UNFCCC, voluntary actions which each country has decided depending on their own situation, circumstances, priorities, etc., and of course the political scenario. Now these are voluntary pledges, and these are pledges which have been done in a bottom-up way. It has got nothing to do with what science demands. So if you now look at, more close to all parties to the UNFCCC have already submitted their pledges, INDCs. But the problem is, if you add up all those pledges, then what you arrive at is not good enough to tackle the problem of climate change in an effective manner, what science demands. And this is something the Paris Agreement itself has acknowledged, and that is the reason there is scope for further ratcheting up, and it urges countries to come up every 5 years with more ambitious INDCs to tackle the problem. Let me not get into further details. What suffices for our purpose, for our discussion here, is that I think that we have a Paris Agreement does not mean that there is no scope for further actions on climate change under the UNFCCC or beyond that. And it also does not mean that there is no need for further action. Actually, there is enormous need for further action. And in that context, let me mention that there have been some discussions, a lot of discussions, I would say, over the recent past about some plurilateral initiatives, just like we are having various plurilateral initiatives under the trade regime, under the climate system also. There have been discussions of plurilateral actions on climate change, what is called climate clubs. Now, the climate clubs, what are they? Actually, this is nothing but a coalition of the willing countries which are willing to do more than what has already been committed under the UNFCCC. Now, the whole idea is that if you have a club of, say, 10, 12 countries, it's a small group, so makes life easier for you to deal with complex issues in a more effective way than what is possible under the multilateral system. Now, for doing more, it is important to have an incentive structure that would enable you to do more. Now, what kind of incentive structure you can think of? That depends on what is the focus of the climate club. And let me tell you that some of the members of the E15 expert group on climate change and trade, including my esteemed colleague Tom Brewer, they have done some very interesting and authoritative work on climate clubs and what may be the focus of these clubs. Without getting into the technical details of those focus areas, one thing is very clear. It talks of an incentive structure that would contain both carrots and sticks. Carrots in the sense that it will create some kind of benefits for the club members, which would be exclusive only to the club members. At the same time, it talks of some kind of sticks or disincentives or penalties being created to disincentivize non-participation by other countries which are not already on board. So you have carrots and you have sticks. But the essential point is, when you are dealing with club approaches, these are essentially discriminatory as between members of the clubs and non-members. Here comes the issue of interaction between this kind of club approaches and the trade regime, because all of us know that the essential cornerstones of the trade regime under the WTO is non-discrimination. We have the MFN, we have national treatment. Now, if for instance some climate club is creating some kind of special benefit, say a zone of lower tariffs is being created for clean energy technologies, then if those benefits are available only to club members and excluded other members, I mean other countries which are excluded are also WTO members, then of course there are issues of violation of MFN. When it comes to penalty, there are issues about to what extent you can use trade measures. For instance, one kind of measure that has been discussed widely is border carbon adjustment, or what is called carbon tariff. Different terms being used for indicating similar kind of measure. Now, if you look at that kind of measure, again the issue comes in that to what extent this is compatible with the WTO law. Is it compatible for with the WTO law? The question is that, and the answer is we do not know, to be sure. Because there are several issues which are not clear. For instance, we know that there is a system under the GATT for border tax adjustment, but whether a carbon tax is adjustable at the border is not clear. Secondly, there are issues about national treatment, where comes the issue of light products. Now, the moot question is, can products be differentiated or regarded as like or non-like solely on the basis of their carbon content? Again, it is not clear. The WTO law and jurisprudence is not clear on those issues. One can of course say that we have the general exception provisions of GATT Article 20 or similar provision under GATS, which can be made use of for environmental exceptions like Article 20B or 20G. It is possible, but as Ingrid was pointing out, so far we are not clear what kind of actions that may be undertaken by countries in order to meet their INDCs would be regarded as climate action. Having said that, if there is a no dispute settlement system under the climate regime, and there are climate actions, so-called or potential climate actions, since it is not defined, which may have trade implications, then automatically if there is a dispute arising, then that would come under the WTO dispute settlement system. So if you are trying to take recourse to the general exceptions, the issue is whether it can be regarded as a climate action, so the WTO law has to take a call on that. So those issues create kind of uncertainty. The main point is there are a lot of uncertainties about the trade law scenario, which needs to be addressed if you are trying to create more predictable atmosphere for climate action at the domestic level. At the same time, there is also scope, in our view, for the trade system to contribute in a big way for climate purposes. And this scope has not been exhausted, not has been used to a great extent. Now, the expert group is trying to exactly address these two things. So what we are trying to do here is to come up with a trade regime and a climate regime which would be mutually consistent, mutually supportive, and mutually reinforcing. Having said that, let me tell you that the whole idea of presenting the options is not to expect that all of them would be implemented, but the whole idea is rather to trigger or initiate or facilitate further discussion among the trade policymakers and climate policymakers. And we hope that if that kind of discussion takes place, at some point in the near future, there will be concrete actions taken. So with the aim of more synergy rather than conflict. So I stop at that. Thank you.
Thank you very much. It's not an easy task to summarize the work of 1.5 years with 20 experts. I don't know how many papers we've written, but we did a really good job. Thank you very much, and we'll move straight to Tom.
Thank you very much. I'm going to begin with two generalizations. They will establish the context in which all of my other comments might be considered. The first one is from the climate change community, a massive scale-up of clean energy technologies is needed worldwide to begin to address successfully the climate change challenge. Virtually every person who thinks about climate change accepts that as that it's a virtual truism. That's number one. Number two is the WTO and other trade organizations can make important contributions to that scale up. The rest of my comments are a little bit more specialized. I will develop three particular recommendations for the WTO. I'm going to be quite presumptuous and suggest what the WTO might do. One thing to keep in mind, lest you be confused if you happen to read the Paris Agreement, which was just reached a few days ago. The Paris Agreement does not mention trade. It does not mention trade. There are about 5 articles on technology transfer, however, but they're all focused on rather detailed sort of internal FCCC sort of managerial structural issues, and therefore, and I don't want you to be deceived, therefore, if you read the Paris Agreement, you might think that the climate change people don't care about trade, or they don't know about trade, or they don't really understand technology transfer. Those would all be erroneous assumptions. That's the preface. Let me suggest 3 kinds of recommendations. The first concerns market failures. The second concerns some specific WTO existing agreements or potential agreements. And thirdly, I'm going to draw on, if I may say so, a little inspiration and some examples from the Trans-Pacific Partnership Agreement, which of course is quite recent. First, about market failures. Most environmental economic analysis, including climate change analysis in particular, begins with a basic assumption about the relationship between markets and governments. And it is that the very problem, the very existence of climate change exists because of market failures, and it's market failures particularly concerning fossil fuels. That's an important part, but the part that I want to focus on is the second kind of market failures, and those are ones that have to do with the development of new technologies. There's a whole branch of economics concerned with the market failures associated with developing new technologies. The inventors often cannot internalize the profits that they might otherwise derive from inventing new technologies. This is especially the case with clean energy technologies because they have very, very long-term planning horizons, literally decades. It may take a decade actually to plan at least some kinds of electric generating projects, and then the project would be in existence for 2, 3, 4, maybe even more than 4 decades, and therefore the planning horizon is extremely long, and it's difficult for the originators to really capture the profits from their inventions. This is rather different from trade thinking, if I may say. The basic central assumption of trade economics is that markets will allocate scarce resources efficiently, and that government interventions tend to, or perhaps nearly always, actually create inefficiency. So this is really basic difference in the whole economic approach, the basic assumptions about the role of markets and governments. So recommendation one to the WTO is that it recognize the legitimacy of this alternative way of thinking about the relationship of markets and governments, that sometimes government intervention is actually necessary to correct for market failures, including market failures in the long-term development of new technologies. That's a rather general possibility. There are many specific ways that the WTO could do that. I will leave to the lawyers and diplomats among you to figure out exactly how to include that in the WTO. Second set of recommendations are much more specific, and they come out of E15 papers, which are enormously, if I may sound like an American self-promoter momentarily, they are enormously informative and thought-provoking. And if I had a hard copy, I would wave it, but it's certainly online. There are many possibilities for specific WTO actions. I'm going to pick initially the one that's, I think, still a live issue right here in Nairobi this week, and that is the Environmental Goods Agreement, and I would hope that it would be adopted and then multilateralized by the WTO. That was the plan. I hope that's still the plan, and I would think it's the kind of thing that could be done this week or certainly by the end of the month. Once you've done that, I should say I was a professor, so I sort of say what I think. Sometimes Ricardo starts to get a little squirmy when he hears me talk because he's been a diplomat. Second possibility, which once you've got the EGA, you work on the ESA, the Environmental Services Agreement. It's obviously much more challenging, but could be done and certainly would be important. Expansion of the government procurement agreement to include more agencies, more countries, and more kinds of goods and services, I would also strongly suggest. There are other possibilities. Again, if you read the E15 papers, you will see lots and lots of specifics. I encourage you to do that. Thirdly, and here I'm going to do something a little potentially scandalous. I'm going to recommend to the WTO what a mega regional has recently agreed to, the TPP, and I'm even going to read very quickly some of the elements of its Chapter 20. And I'm doing that in hopes that there you might see examples in this of what the WTO could do, and also more generally for a little inspiration, which we all need from time to time. excuse me. I'm not going to read the whole thing. It's about 20 pages. Very quickly. These are all in Article 20, 3. The parties recognize the sovereign right of each party to establish its own levels of domestic environmental protection and its own environmental priorities, and to establish or modify its environmental laws and policies accordingly. That's a pretty sweeping statement. Much more specific, I've been doing some work actually on international shipping, so I'm quite sensitive to these issues these days. Each party shall take measures to prevent the pollution of the marine environment from ships, and a long list of about 8 very specific ones, including emissions from ships, including increased protection in special geographic areas. When I read that, I think the Arctic region, which is of special interest to me. But the point is that they've really gone to great lengths. And the final one, which some of you know, I'm sure, because you were at least marginally involved in the discussions with your colleagues, 20.15 was for a while called the climate change article. One of the negotiators, who happens to be the government of the country that I come from, didn't want climate change to be mentioned for domestic political reasons. You all understand all of that. And so it ended up being called the transition to low emissions and resilient economy. And it says, among other things, the parties shall cooperate, to address matters of joint or common interest. Areas of cooperation may include, or but not limited to, energy efficiency, cost-effective low emissions technologies, clean and renewable energy sources, sustainable transport and sustainable urban infrastructure development, blah, 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 emissions monitoring, market and non-market mechanisms, and it goes on and on and on. And it says they shall cooperate to do this. So I suggest that the WTO might read Chapter 20 and consider the possibilities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Tom. Let me just mention quickly that Tom has actually come up with a proposal for a very specific climate club. So if we have a few minutes during the discussion, maybe you would like to say a few words about that as well. So let's move now to Ricardo, who's going to speak about subsidies.
So thank you very much, both Castoria and Thomas, for that review. As both of you said, the discussions in these two groups were very rich, and they came out with a great number of proposals. In some writing that I was doing late last night, I summarized the main proposals from the two groups in 16, sort of the most impactful ones, would be about 16 of them. And I think you've covered most of them. The point that I think is important to stress here is that there is a great space and a great potential for the WTO, for regional trade agreements, and trade policy to support climate action. And that has been really the conclusion of the work of the two groups. Clean energy technologies is particularly important and has been driven in the past, basically since 1975, when the Kyoto Protocol was negotiated in 1997 when it came into being, has been driven in its growth by the concern to act on climate action. But it's also interesting for other reasons. It also provides energy security, and it also provides it's a great opportunity to provide energy access to populations that don't have access to energy, or to resolve problems of energy poverty, which is very relevant to Africa as well. But let me go back to clean energy technologies. We work on the clean energy technology file, thinking about, again, its potential to support climate action. The Paris Agreement and climate action is really about shifting the energy supply from fossil fuels to clean energy. That's really what it is, all about. Let me just give you a few numbers on where we are. The Paris Agreement was concluded on the basis of what countries presented and Kasari described before, these intended national determined contributions, which was an indication of how they would intend again to address climate action. Most of these INDCs, if not all of them, include the energy-related targets, particularly about scaling up clean energy technology, but also energy efficiency. If you look at the INDCs and you do an assessment of how the implementation of the INDCs would change really the situation with respect to emissions, what you find out is by 2030, we will continue to have a very big gap. Because in technical numbers, emissions will continue to increase by 3.7 gigatons of CO2 equivalent, which would leave us at something like 2.7 degrees above pre-industrial levels in terms of climate. Being 2 degrees or 1.5 now after the Paris Agreement, really the ambition. So the point there again is that even with those intended national contributions, so the plans that countries are putting on the table to try to shift the situation with the use of clean energy technologies, the effort is not sufficient. So we will need an additional effort. If you look at the trends on investment, as I said before, we have done a study that is very interesting, looking at innovation in clean energy technologies, and so we use the filing of patents, look at the filing of patents in 80 offices, patent offices around the world, classified clean energy technologies, looking at the components of the technologies using customs classification. And what we found is that since 1995, there is a surge in innovation, which accompanies also a very impressive surge in investment. But even if you look at that, at those trends that are marked by those surges, what you find is also a huge investment gap. If you want to reach, again, the type of goals that would then lead to a reduction of emissions that could take us to the 2% or the 2 degrees or the 1.5 degrees that we're aiming for. Investment in fossil fuels, which is what we're trying to substitute, continues to be much higher than investment in renewable energies on an annual basis. They're almost now level of the investment in renewable energies last year that are around $250 million. And in fossil fuels, around $290 million. So they're almost now at the par. But we continue to invest on those fossil fuels and continue to, again, if we look at business as usual rates of growth, even with that very high rate of growth of investment, as I said before, there is a gap of about $51 trillion before we can reach really the kind of a scale up that is necessary to bring about the changes in climate. So what do we do about all this? So we have looked at a number of policies that could help us address that situation through the trade system. The first one, which is very obvious and many people have been acting on it now in the policy sphere, but particularly from a rhetoric, political at least stance, is the elimination of fossil fuel subsidies. Now, fossil fuel subsidies, depending on how you count them, if you look at the cost to society of the subsidies that the IMF did this early this year, you're talking about $5.3 trillion or 6.5% of world GDP, which is a huge number. If you look just at the numbers, so the subsidies that are being, this is the monies that are being transferred by governments for fossil fuels, they're about $600 billion. So again, they continue to be a very big amount. Part of the problem that we have is that the information is not in full certainty. The IISD runs a project called the Global Subsidies Initiative, which has the best data together with the OECD on these subsidies. And even that would not be fully accurate, because it's very hard to account. Governments do not notify anywhere the subsidies that they provide to fossil fuels. So the first thing to do is to come up with regulation in the WTO, for instance, on this full disclosure of fossil fuels. Once you have full disclosure, then you could, for instance, decide to make fossil fuel subsidies actionable under WTO subsidies agreement, which means that then countries could take other countries to dispute to try to get reform and gradually prohibit their use in time. So that's one obvious route that has been taken, and again, all countries know that this is a priority concern, but there's very little action on that. On a parallel agenda, which is interesting, there's a discussion of fishery subsidies, as you all know, and fishery subsidies contain also fossil fuel subsidies. So when we talk about fossil fishery subsidies, we're also talking about a very large content of subsidies that go to fossil fuel. I'm seeing Rashid sitting back there, and he has the best information in the world, Rashid Somalia, on how to count these subsidies. And again, it's very hard because governments don't notify them. But from your latest estimates, Rashid, we know that they are about 20% of all the subsidies in fisheries go to fossil fuels, which is about $7.7 billion a year. And they contribute also, obviously, to greenhouse gas emissions. So there are two ways of tackling these fossil fuel subsidies, or two avenues, using the subsidies agreement of the WTO, which doesn't have the teeth today, really, to tackle them. So it would need a negotiation and a consultation to do this. And then the fossil fuel subsidies, the fishery subsidies negotiations. Now, moving to something more parochial, the clean energy technologies are made up of components. When you set up a windmill or a solar plant, these are thousands of components that make it. Those components in a globalized economy like today's are usually the result of assembling pieces that come from various jurisdictions. Those pieces, on top of that, contain some of them services that are embedded in them, for instance, software devices that would make the component usable or not, and they also need associated services so that they can be useful in the equipment that is going to be installed. There's also the need for services to assemble, install, operate, and maintain any equipment on clean energy technologies. Those services, as well as, again, those goods, those components, all are traded today in international markets. And so the question here is, if we want to scale up massively the use of clean energy technology, we want to make sure that the markets are robust and that the markets are efficient, so that these components can be sourced where they are less expensive, and again, we can really take up this humongous task that countries have agreed to do in Paris. So there are very simple trade tasks here, or there are some simple tasks for the trade system. One is liberalize the tariffs that are involved, and that's what the Environmental Goods Agreement is partly doing. The Environmental Goods Agreement, so far in the lists that have been negotiated, and we'll hear more from Ambassador Cedeño, who's involved in those negotiations, includes some of those components of clean energy technologies. But there's still more that would probably need to be included to make it really an agreement that would have an effect on these markets. Then there is a need to negotiate also non-tariff barriers to those components, and there's a need also to negotiate services that are associated to those components. And indeed, it poses a question that is very interesting for the trade system, which is whether in the current economy, in the global economy today, it makes sense to negotiate market access for goods and services in separate tracks and completely uncoordinated and unrelated tracks. We know from these negotiations of the EGA that many of the components that would be liberalized may not be really effectively tradable if the services that are necessary with them are not liberalized as well. The problem with the liberalization of services is that we don't have a classification of the services that we need to look into to, improve those markets. So we need to work on a services classification also for renewable energy technologies, which is something that is a pending task in the trade system. Then going down the road again from the obvious trade-related issues, we have additional duties that are imposed on imports of these technologies when they're deemed to be sold at dumping prices in the import markets. So we have seen a particular appetite to target both solar photovoltaic equipment as well as wind energy equipment. As the industry grows in responding to that investment curves and consolidates and relocates in different manufacturing economies. The situation with that targeting of those clean energy technologies is such that, for instance, in the European Union, 70% of the revenues today that come from remedies come from cases that involve renewable energy technologies. And the situation is similar in Japan and the US. So there's a particular appetite, as I said before, which is explainable for many reasons. And I'm not saying that is not legitimate to use remedies when there is dumping. But there are ways, if we want to increase again and improve those markets for clean energy technology, that there are ways in which we can improve the use of those remedy provisions and the remedy agreements that we have in the WTO, for instance, so that we can do things in a way that is more supportive of markets. One of those ways is to target anti-competitive behavior rather than simple price discrimination using antitrust law. And something else is to limit trade remedies on clean energy technologies with respect to level, to time, to number, and value of imports. To include in anti-dumping investigations on clean energy technologies a public interest test, something that is done in other investigations on anti-dumping. And for instance, to make climate change a criteria for public interest test. So again, if we want to be coherent and we want the trade system to support, again, action on climate, those may be some issues that I need to speed up. So I speak too slow. And I have several more things to say, so let me just rush through them because I think it's important and I'll do it in 1 minute. One is that what to do with subsidies that are used particularly in energy policy. So we saw the case of the use of feed-in tariffs, which is compounded with local content requirements, and then constitutes a subsidy, and it's again deemed to be a violation of the WTO TRIMS agreement. There are other types of subsidies that are being used. So for clean energy technologies, again, if we're interested in climate action and we really need to support that massive scale-up, should we think about some sort of exception to subsidies, to certain types of subsidies that are supportive of those kind of policies? And they could be, technically speaking, there could be exceptions that could be agreed through under Article 20 of the GATT or within the subsidies agreement. A clean energy waiver could also be a way to address this. The two other points, and I finished there, have to do with, that's another big area, but it's the fact that not all countries would have the natural conditions to use clean energy technologies. We see it already in the plans that countries are making. Switzerland is a case in point. They will have to source across the border. And to source across the border, for instance, geothermal from Iceland to supply the Swiss market, you would need, again, frameworks that will be supportive of grids that could do this kind of job. So again, there's work that we have done in this respect that shows how these kind of frameworks for electricity grids could be supportive of climate action. Yes, but finally, to finish where Tom left it, the regional trade agreements and the regional trade space is quite interesting in promoting climate action. So again, there is a number of policy options that we have been looking at that built on what is already being done in a number of agreements in several areas that relate both to clean energy technologies scale up as well as to climate action. But we can come back to some of those things in the discussion.
Thank you very much, Ricardo. That was way beyond subsidies, but I think it was very complimentary and very helpful. It's always very challenging to ask your boss to stop talking. So now we will turn to the discussants. There were many very concrete proposals put forward that you may want to react to. Both Denmark and Costa Rica are actually members of this environmental goods agreement that was being referred to several times, which is currently being negotiated. So I'm sure you will want to comment on that and on the other options that were presented. So, Jakob, would you like to go first?
Sure. Oops. Thank you very much, Ingrid, and I promise I will be brief. But first of all, let me just make one short comment to the E15 initiative, because I think it's really good. I think it's really necessary. It's really timely that we have this kind of brainstorming on several issues to help foster new political development. And I think not least, this is necessary for the WTO at the time. So I'll come back to that. So I just wanted to give my appreciation of what you're doing here with this initiative in general. My background is I am a diplomat, so I don't necessarily say what I mean. But I would say that to a large extent, Tom actually said what I meant. In other words, I very much agree to the conclusions and the recommendations that he came up with. I think actually it's very interesting that more or less we have more or less the same conclusions here, and we didn't coordinate the interventions beforehand, but we came up with more or less the same ideas that you have here. So I think that's, I don't know if there's something to build on there, but that's certainly very interesting that we end up in the same place. What we can perhaps provide here is, with our government perspective, is a little bit of realism. In other words, not what should be done, but also what can be done. Because I think, and I'm sure my colleague here from Costa Rica will echo that to get results on the ground is actually very, very difficult. This stuff, it doesn't mean that we shouldn't try, but it's very difficult to actually get results, especially when we talk about the WTO. So basically, I would just limit myself to having two kind of observations, some regarding the WTO and the nature and logic, or perhaps sometimes lack of logic, that is a characteristic of the WTO, and some comments on your concrete proposals. Now, first on the WTO, of course, the intention of the WTO is to break down trade barriers and facilitate trade and to counter protectionism and, in general, to liberalize world trade. And I think we should always be cautious when we talk about derogations and limitations and deviations to the acquis that has already been agreed in the WTO, because it's our experience that once you start to unravel what is already agreed, many countries will try to exploit that to the maximum. So this is exactly what Kasturi was mentioning before, that we risk opening the Pandora's box, and that gets us very suspicious. And I think we speak out of experience here, that you should try to keep the acquis as clean as possible. I think it's also necessary to comment on the current momentum, or perhaps lack of momentum, that we see at the WTO for the time being. In other words, I guess it's not very likely that we get a very ambitious result here in Nairobi on the ministerial conference. And this has led also to a more general discussion about the function, or perhaps lack of functioning of the WTO. Some say we need a new narrative for the organization. Many of us agree that we need to include new issues in order for the institution to be more effective and actually create results. Some say that WTO may be flawed in the design, that it can't take decisions. Some say we need to get away from the single undertaking. But what I'm saying is here that a lot of discussing is going on about not the issues themselves, but basically the lack of ability to take decisions. And it may actually be that this discussion here we have on climate change may actually fit in well if we're able to a little bit to redesign the organization in the wake of lack of results in Nairobi. So I think the discussion here may be timely. Just a few observations on our experiences from the EGA. First of all, it started off very well, surprisingly well, and we advanced negotiations quite quickly. But at the same time, it's proven that it's been difficult to distinguish environmental goods on the basis of HS codes. In other words, the system is certainly not designed to identify environmentally friendly goods. I think also we can observe, and you may disagree with that, but we can observe that the original logic was to basically to do good on climate and environment. But after a year or more of negotiation, I think the process has changed a bit. Now the purpose seems to be more mixed, leaning towards short-term economic benefits for the countries. And I think my point here is that the devil is in the detail. We thought we would be able to present an agreement here at Nairobi. But I'm sorry, Tom, we will not present it in a week's time or two. It will take a little longer. But it's still our hope that we could do in the beginning of next year. But it turned out that to wrap up this agreement was far more difficult than what we had thought. And let me just give you one example on how this is actually difficult when you get down into the detail. The question of bicycles. It's been the position of the Danish government that bicycles should certainly be on the list because it's obviously a very environmentally friendly product, and you could probably not think of a more environmentally friendly product. But then on the other side of the argument, you have some countries arguing that the production of bicycle is not at all perhaps environmentally or climate friendly. So should it be on or not? I mean, we had fairly long discussions on this specific product and on others as well. Okay, my other comments would be on the proposals that are in this very good document, and I would start by saying that we I see a lot of very, very good and very interesting proposals. Coming back to my initial comment, I think it's really good that you have the ability to take a step back and kind of free think a bit of constructive proposals out of the box. But thereby, I'm also saying that they may not all be completely realistic, in my view. If we look at the very good ones, the ones that actually talk about what you call climate clubs or establish a group of front runners, plurilateral agreements recognized by the WTO and WTO Plus, I think that those are really good. And this comes back to, I think, my main recommendation here is that we also, in the wake of the lack of progress in the WTO, that we look at what we can achieve on the bilateral track. You mentioned the TPP and what was in there on climate issues there. We have, on the European side, we have a trade policy negotiation with the Americans, the TTIP, where we hope that we can establish global rules also within this area. We have just proposed a sustainability chapter. It doesn't mention climate, actually, but it does mention environment as such, and it's still under negotiations, so this would be a very good place, actually, to increase to increase climate change as an important consideration here. And I think this is, on the short term, this may be the one of the main ways forward, because the WTO track doesn't seem to be delivering for the time being. And other good proposals regarding the ban on binational government procurement. We very much like that idea. Again, it's proven difficult, and it will prove difficult to change that. But the idea that you ban the binational procurement arrangements, we think are very good. Mutual recognition and harmonization of environmental standards is very good. And I like the idea also, Ricardo, on the disclosure of fossil fuel subsidies, because you are completely right, they are enormous. The proposals that may prove more difficult are those, in my opinion, that are regarding the derogations and waivers to the WTO acquis. You have a proposal regarding a peace clause for climate action that we see as potentially dangerous if you start to again to unravel the acquis. And you have something also on special and differential treatment that may be not so easy. I mean, we're not against the proposal as such, but we can just see out of experience that once you start to do these things, countries will exploit them over the over and above what was the intention. So I'm just going to finish on saying that what do we do in the near future? Again, we hope to conclude the EGA very soon. That's certainly a low-hanging fruit, and we should get it as ambitious as possible and making sure that it takes into account the real climate and environmental issues. And then on the longer time, we should certainly also look at the bilateral trade agreements for actually changing action here. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Jacob. I think we'll move straight to Alvaro, since the first race.
Thank you very much. It has been a rich learning experience, as always, here at the ICTSD. So I fought my way to be here, not with you, but with my minister, as he is speaking right now at the WTO, and I am missing him. Missing his speech, not him. So I just want to very briefly comment on some of the things we've already heard today. First, I would say from Dr. Das's presentation that my feeling after being at the WTO for 1 year is that it might help to revisit the purpose of the WTO. It has not forgotten where it comes from, but it might have gotten lost as to why it is there. Perhaps it's just a matter of definition. The definition of development that is used at the WTO is very suitable for the 20th century. So maybe we need to work on that definition. Second, I think that the COP21 from last week has given us a very interesting tipping point in our human history. And to put it simply, I think that we reached an understanding of the problem from a science and from a policy perspective. So this week, we are living in a completely different world. Regarding the WTO law, I am a lawyer, but I promise I'll never do it again. I do understand that the law is dynamic and that it is meant to change over time. So whatever has worked in the past might not necessarily work in the future. And as the ambassador just said, we have to be very careful how we meddle with that, but we shouldn't be afraid to think that the law can change. Moving on to what Thomas was mentioning, I think it's important to see innovation in two directions. One of them is vertical innovation, you know, when there's a new product that literally jumps to a new stage. And another kind of innovation is the horizontal innovation, the scaling up globally. So technology needs a little bit of both, a little bit of bringing up new things and bringing some new things that already work to the rest of the world, and mostly to the part of the world where it might be most needed. To give an example, if we're going to scale up solar or wind or other mobile sources of renewables, we should start by addressing the problem in countries where people use trees to cook and to heat up and to make some industrial production. So that would work on two different fronts at the same time, reducing deforestation and replacing that source of fuel for a cleaner one or a more renewable one. Thomas, I've taken note of Article 20 of the TPP. Thank you very much. That's homework takeaway. Going on to Ricardo's presentation, well, Costa Rica had celebrated last week 67 years of not having a military army. And every time that I hear the conversation about investment for renewables and investment for climate action, I always think, why not tap onto the $1.5 trillion a year that we spend globally on military armament. Maybe we could use that money to fight the battle that needs to be fought. I'm not going to speak much about the EGA. I think the ambassador made a very eloquent statement about it. And also, I think I'll speak about EGA later in the afternoon. But I do want to touch upon something that Ricardo mentioned. The fact that EGA is not the only potentially helpful solution that could come from the WTO. There is also services, and I would also add digital economy, because a combination of the three of them do represent very clearly the low carbon economy that we need to move towards. So in that regard, I think Costa Rica has been a good example of how you can adapt to a low carbon economy world. And then, just briefly to talk about bicycles, I am one of the few, if not the only ambassador that commutes by bicycle in Geneva. and when I was in Japan before this posting, we set up a green growth agenda with Japan. And one of the arguments that we were elaborating was, could we manufacture low emissions vehicles in a country that already generates almost all its electricity from renewable sources? So could we not only produce a good that is going to be better for the environment, but produce it in a better way? So we are most welcome to manufacture bicycles in Costa Rica. And Yeah, well, I guess I could leave it up to that. Just briefly mention maybe that agriculture is also a very potentially good source of transformation in terms of making it smart, making it more efficient in terms of energy, in terms of water use, in terms of agrochemicals that do not enrich the fertility of the soil. And keeping in mind that forests and agriculture do build up what we have as natural capital in the world, and we can also increase that natural capital. We can also shift the trend that we have seen for so many decades of our natural capital diminishing. So I think we have to figure out a way through policy, through technology, to regenerate ecosystems that, if we want to talk about monetization, do have a very significant impact in our economy. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I think this example of bicycles that you have both mentioned is very relevant, and it's something that has been discussed in the climate change E15, the issue of embedded carbon, and I think that we have said in that group that that's really one of the big future issues in the area of trade and climate change. So Anka, the floor is yours now.
Thank you very much, and thank you Ingrid and Ricardo for inviting me to this very interesting discussion. As Ingrid mentioned, I work for Siemens. Some people at the reception 2 days ago asked me if I was selling mobile phones. That is not the case. Siemens is a global manufacturing company. We are our activities are basically along the value chain of electrification, automation, and digitalization. What does that mean? That sounds a bit grandiose. We have all kinds of equipment and services around, for example, gas turbines, wind turbines. We have mobility equipment like metros, high-speed trains, automation equipment for manufacturers, but also medical devices. So it's a very wide-ranging company. We have around 300 manufacturing locations worldwide. So as you can imagine, we are trading a lot as a company with our customers, but also intra-company trade between those different manufacturing locations. And that's, of course, for us the reason to be here, to support the multilateral system. Of course, now the talk of the day is about TTIP and TPP, but I can tell you, even in a large company like Siemens, if I talk to my customs department, they are on the one hand excited about the opportunities that regional trade agreements provide, but they are also frustrated because they see that the uniformity which was provided by the WTO is not there anymore, and they see all these different rules emerging. And of course, when this is a problem for a large company like Siemens, you can imagine how difficult it is for SMEs to understand the different rules that are put in place by different bilateral agreements. So I think the WTO continues to have a crucial role to play, but it has to show that it can actually still get its act together also on the negotiation front. So moving on to the clean technologies and the interlinkage between trade and environment. I was very fortunate to be at the COP21 conference last week to talk about the Environmental Goods Agreement. And one of the great things I got to speak about there is that my CEO announced a few weeks ago that Siemens is aiming to be the first manufacturing company worldwide to aim for zero carbon emissions by the year 2030. So we want to have a zero carbon emissions by 2030. And we're doing that because we, of course, think it's a good thing to do, and we want to communicate about that. But at the same time, because we think it makes business sense to do that. And we're talking a lot about scaling up of technologies to mitigate climate change. And a lot of these technologies are actually available on the market. So we've calculated that we'll be investing around 100 million euros over the next year, I believe. But we are also expecting that our energy costs will go down with 20 million as a result of that annually. So it's an investment that makes sense, and the technologies are out there for companies and governments that are serious about climate change mitigation. Then just moving on to the environmental goods agreement, and I agree very much with the points that were made by Mr. Brewer. I think the environmental goods agreement, it's a very exciting discussion among a diverse group of countries. It's unfortunate that it's a discussion that is limited to tariffs, and I think Mr. Brewer also mentioned that the services component is very important there. Realism is important, as Jacob mentioned, so voila, that's where we are now. We have a discussion on tariffs, and Siemens is very eager to see an ambitious agreement to come out of the environmental goods negotiations. It's also my understanding that these negotiations will take a little bit longer. So, of course, if there are countries that have not yet joined these negotiations but are eager to do so, it is still possible to shape these talks by joining them. So I would definitely recommend countries to take a look into that. What else do I want to say? Yeah, just coming back to the point that was made on TPP and the TPP language, I think that's an excellent suggestion. Promoting something that is not TPP, but something that is originating more from the Brussels side where I have my daily life. In an agreement that the EU has negotiated with Singapore, which is still to be officially ratified but has been concluded, there's a very interesting annex, which is called the Green Technology Annex, where also the EU and Singapore have thought about making rules regarding green technology and how can you think about rules in this area. So I think it's also a lesson for the World Trade Organization that, unfortunately, if the multilateral system does not manage to discuss these subjects that are very important, like climate change, like global data flows and things like that, that in other forums these discussions will be held, like, for example, in the TPP or in other bilateral talks. So I'll finish there just to say, so Siemens is very serious about climate change mitigation. We have a portfolio of products that is ready to assist, not mobile phones. And we're very supportive of the environmental goods agreement. So we hope that the negotiators will find a way to conclude, if not in the coming weeks, in the coming months. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Anka. I think it's very important to have the business perspective as well in this discussion, which can otherwise become a bit academic. I've been a terrible time manager. We're already running out of time, but I would like to open up the floor for one or two comments or questions. Okay, I see three hands. So let's take those three, and then I would like to go back to the presenters and give you a chance to respond both to the question and comments from the floor as well as to the ones that were raised by our discussants. So, Wei, would you like to go first? Please introduce yourself.
I'm Wei from Van Ballenbellies. I in fact have around 10 questions or comments, but I only raised two now. And the first one is, because you are Dr. Dust is talking about respective capacities or differentiated capacities, because Article 4 of UNFCCC was designed to address the differentiated capacities by obliging developed countries to provide financial and technological support to developing countries. So technology transfer is quite important. And Thomas also mentioned the importance of a wider dissemination of technology, clean energy technology. And also Ricardo said there has been a surge of innovation of clean energy technologies. However, in practice, the innovation of clean energy technologies is mainly highly concentrated in OECD countries, with like 95% within OECD countries and 75% within a handful of developed countries. So that's really important to have a transfer of clean energy technologies or some enabling environment to promote the transfer. So my question is, there is new provisions in the Paris Agreement related to development and transfer of technologies. How would these provisions can contribute to innovation and transfer of environmental some technologies or clean energy technologies? In particular, how would they address the potential barriers such as anti-competitive practice in the process of transfer of technologies, and also how would it help to create an evolving environment to stimulate innovation. That's the first one. The second one, in brief, is about the object. And you said there is a lack of coordination between UFCCC, between trade and the climate change. In fact, we shared, you also talked about they don't have clear objective, or in fact, they share the same objective, is sustainable development. In the preamble of the WTO agreement, funding agreement, it is explicitly recognized sustainable development as objective, and also member states of WTO has several times have always committed to sustainable development objective. And with UNFCCC, Article 3.4 recognizes sustainable development as principle. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. Those were very complex questions. I don't think we can expect our panelists to be experts on the Paris outcome quite yet, but maybe later on, Kasturi would like to talk about what the E15 has said about innovation. No, let's take the remaining questions first. David, please.
Thanks very much. I'm David Runnels from ICTSD. I'd like to draw Ricardo out a bit more on the subsidies question. When we started the Global Subsidies Initiative, 7 or 8 years ago, one of the hidden agendas of Sylvia Austry, who's one of the great trade economists, was to try and persuade or structure the thing in such a way that the WTO was persuaded to set up a review mechanism for subsidies similar to the trade policy review mechanisms. In fact, you'd have a subsidies policy review mechanism, which would do a number of things, not the least of which is it might force countries to actually report on subsidies for a change. But the TPRM's been a very effective tool. Countries do take these things quite seriously. And I wonder, Ricardo, given that the WTO has now taken this a little bit, that the IMF has now taken it in a serious way, the G20, blah, 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 everybody's now said that next to motherhood, getting rid of fossil fuel subsidies must be the best thing in the world. So is it now time to begin to prod the WTO a little bit? Somebody has to take the initiative to do more than just calculate everything and put it in a spreadsheet the way the IMF and the OECD do.
Okay, thank you very much, David. And then we have a last question here on the front row. Please. I'm afraid we'll have to close the floor for questions after that.
Well, interestingly enough, my question was basically along your lines, because I was going to ask Ricardo about whether you're seeing any progress or sort of any steps being taken, especially in the developing world, to remove subsidies on fossil fuels now that oil prices are so low. And also, if this is an issue that could be brought into the WTO realm in some way, because it is obviously very harmful towards the spread of environmental goods, which we are, of course, also very supportive of. And I should say, maybe I come from the Confederation of Danish Industry.
Okay, thank you very much for all those very relevant and difficult questions. Kasturi, would you like to go first?
Yeah. Thank you very much. I think it's rather a comment than a question. Very important points you raised. On the issue of technology transfer, very important. I do agree with you. And let me share with you that I didn't get a chance to get into the specifics of the options that have been offered by the trade and climate group of E15. But there is an option which deals with furthering the transfer of technology in the context of this. It says that speed the spread of new green technologies by improving the provisions in WTO intellectual property rules on green technology transfer to least developed and other developing countries. A new WTO working party should be appointed to explore and recommend ways of striking an appropriate balance to meet the needs of both access and innovation. So there is a provision which has been touched upon, but having said that, if you come to the issue of a Paris Agreement and how it deals with technology transfer, here I'm giving my own view, not the expert group's view. I think one important issue that has been left out because of it's very contentious is about the intellectual property rights. which is not part of the Paris Agreement. So one can raise a concern to what extent you can have adequate action without addressing IP issues if you look at it from developing country perspective. The second issue is about sustainable development. Yes, that is something we are trying to say, that in today's world when we are talking about interconnectedness of climate regime and trade regime, that is the reason we are saying that we cannot have it as mutually exclusive. And I wrote a small piece for E15 in which I started with this, how if you look at the preamble to GATT and preamble to the WTO, how it has moved from how do you deal with natural resources to move to more sustainable ways of dealing with it. So that is where we are, from where we are coming. And I also think that WTO has shown, sent enough signal to create room for such actions on climate and sustainable development. If you look at the latest, after the completion of the 20 years of WTO, a small brief came out from WTO and UNEP, in which they have looked at how WTO can accommodate more environment-related concerns. So I fully agree with your view on that. Thank you.
Just a quick reply to the very specific question based on the observation first that innovation is highly concentrated in OECD countries. That's a fact. And the question then is what to do about it. Just one specific possibility. The FCCC does have a technology mechanism. It's somewhat controversial. It has some administrative issues. It does include what are essentially transnational hubs whose purpose is specifically, although it's not actually made explicit, but it is to actually facilitate diffusion of energy, of climate-friendly energy technologies outside the OECD countries. So you might look into that.
Thank you very much. So I would like to give a chance to the discussants if you would like to come back and comment on any of the questions. Or
just a very brief. I think I failed to make a point when I spoke and I talked about the purpose of the WTO and the definition of development. Maybe it would help to see climate change also as a common enemy in the trade policy arena. So it has worked, and obviously in the climate change negotiations, and I think we have to start to break the silos and see things in a multidimensional way, like Dr. Das said at the beginning. Thank you.
Maybe just a small comment regarding the Environmental Goods Initiative. I was asked yesterday, so what would be the interest of countries that don't produce environmental technologies in this initiative? And from my perspective, this initiative is as much about export as it is about import. For me, the Environmental Goods Agreement is about making climate technologies more affordable.
Thank you very much. I think that's an important comment, and it's good to remind the trade delegates about that, since the trade negotiations are based on a more mercantilist approach. It was not by accident that I skipped Ricardo. I wanted to save him for last, so that he gets a chance to give a few closing remarks as well.
Thank you, Ingrid. I think people here would get the impression that I'm the boss when I only follow direction here. They tell me what I do, when I do it, and so thank you for that. I hope that we have another session, or at least I think two sessions more, to discuss these issues. These issues are merit much more of a discussion, particularly the question of the AGA and all its various aspects, but also about the Paris Agreement. I think we haven't done really much justice to look into the Paris Agreement and their fascinating futures that are coming out of there. But just quickly, maybe to respond to some of the comments made, start with something simple. Yes, the problem with the WTO, in a way, when you're trying to deal with these kind of issues, is that there is a mercantilist culture in the WTO, which is the result of the way in which negotiations have been set up. And that's very difficult to escape. So that's why the emphasis is on exports, and it obviously ends up in that kind of in the kind of discussion that was just introduced. What is the role of imports? Where we know what role in economic terms the importance of imports, what it means, including for the transfer of technology, but it's also more critical when you're talking about these kind of issues. So you have to make a decision whether you want to establish manufacturing capacity or whether what you want to do is generate, change your energy supply mix. Then, two quick other questions. Well, on the question of subsidies, just to respond to that, yes, there are some countries that are taking the opportunity of the low prices. We've seen reform in Indonesia, in India. There are a few other countries that have started some reform. The WTO, to the question of David, is and it's not equipped to deal with this. That's the problem. So you really have to develop. That's why I say we should start with the transparency provisions, but then there's also the need to do some to come up with some rulemaking that would tackle specifically the kind of subsidies that we're trying to deal with. With the rules that we have today, we cannot do it. And there's so much that we can do by making some of those subsidies actionable, but most of them probably would not capture them in the current agreement on subsidies. So that's also part of a larger agenda that we're proposing, which is the review of the subsidies agreement in the WTO. So I think go to the comment that was also made before. Our task is sort of to dream about what should be the role of the trade system, and then the diplomats would have to try to make to do what is possible. Right? So we dream, and you're realistic. Real about what are the possibilities. So we do that. So we will be presenting also some proposals in that respect. Just a quick comment I think I have to make is with respect to the Paris Agreement. So there's a lot of enthusiasm, and of course it has very interesting futures. I mean, the universality, not least, also the high ambition, the mechanisms to ratchet that ambition. But there's no enforcement mechanism other than sort of a peer review type of, if you want to call it that way, mechanism in the agreement. And so the implementation, the burden of implementation is left to national governments. And it's not clear that implementation is going to be coordinated. It's also, it's going to be very difficult to really try to understand what are the effects of the various type of measures that will be taken on the trade system, and which measures will be covered legally by the UNFCCC. So if I have an NDC, a national determined contribution, that it's a plan of climate measures, and I adopt measures under the aegis of that NDC, am I covered legally from, say, the WTO? And that's, I put this question to all of you here, is because that was the question that most worried the theme leader of the climate change group in the E15, Jim Backus. Having been the chairman of the appellate body for 8 years, he continues to be very concerned about this, the need to define clearly what is a climate measure under the UNFCCC, and so that you can treat it under WTO law as well. Otherwise, anything of what we have seen in the NDCs, and there's huge amount of very interesting material there, could be discriminatory and could be really in violation of WTO. So there's a huge need, and I think is a priority need, for regime coherence. And that regime coherence, we're making some proposals in the E15 policy options as well, would have to come with a dialogue between the two regimes. How to establish that dialogue is going to be quite difficult. Now, one of the proposals that we have made there, again, knowing politically how difficult that is, for instance, to mandate something like a systemic mutual we call it something like a mutual, I call it systemic assessment of mutual implications, where you mandate certain bodies of the WTO to look at the implications that the climate change regime or the measures taken under it has in the WTO, and then you mandate one of the subsidiary bodies of the UNFCCC to do the same thing. And look at that, that way you start bringing some coherence. But there's another, there are a number of policy options that we have come up with that are exactly in that direction. I put this forward here because I think it's the biggest issue really that comes out of the Paris Agreement. We're now under a legal regime, which was, that was one of the biggest efforts in Paris, to make it a treaty that was binding. So we're under a legal regime that would change the way in which we look at many of these measures and policies, and actually will determine the means we go for lunch. I think someone over there wants to go for lunch.
Okay. So, so we'll it would be 12:30.
But I'll finish there, right? So it would determine really how we manage, again, global interdependence in a very big way going forward. So that's one of the big questions that we have to respond to. I'll finish here. I'll let you just thank Ingrid for a great job. She's been a very patient manager of the two groups. I've been a member of the two groups and the team leader of the Clean Energy Technologies Group, and so I know that that calls for extra patience. So thank you very much, Ingrid. Thank you, all of you, for your participation. Jacob, for the support of Denmark to all these issues. Denmark has been a partner in all these themes now for a number of years with us, and so we appreciate that very much. And Alvaro as well, and Costa Rica is the only country in Latin America, and I would say, strictly speaking, developing country that is part of this agreement called EGA, and so we appreciate also very much the perspectives of Alvaro always in those sessions. So thank you all very much for your